Good morning and welcome to the 28th meeting in 2024 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. And I remind all members and witnesses to ensure their devices and notifications are on silent. We have received apologies from Mark Griffin, MSP, and I welcome Alexander Stewart, MSP, and Megan Gallagher, MSP, to the committee. And I'd like to invite Alexander Stewart, MSP, to declare any relevant interests. Alexander.
Good morning, convener. Delighted to be a member of this committee, as I was in the previous session for the last 4 years. And the only declaration of interest I have is that I was a serving councillor for Perth and Kinross Council for 18 years between 1999 and 2017, but nothing else to declare. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that, and really glad to have your presence on the committee. And Megan Gallagher, MSP, I'd like to invite you to declare any relevant interests.
Well, thank you very much, convener, and it's great to be back at this committee, and I look forward to working with you all once more. The only declaration of interest I have at present is that I was a serving councillor at North Lanarkshire Council between 2017 and 2021. But of course, if there's any future declarations of interest, I will certainly update the committee as and when appropriate. Thank you.
Thanks very much, and great to have you back. The second item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 7 to 12 in private. Are members agreed? We're all agreed. Thank you. The next item on our agenda is to take evidence from Ivan McKee, who's the Minister for Public Finance, on the following SSIs: the Town and Country Planning Amendment of National Planning Framework, Scotland Regulation 2024, Master Consent Area Scheme, Environmental Impact Assessment, Scotland Regulations 2024, Town and Country Planning Amendment of Local Development Plan, Scotland Regulations 2024, and the Town and Country Planning Master Consent Areas, Scotland Regulations. And the Minister is joined by the Scottish Government officials, Kirsten Anderson, who's the Head of Development and Planning, Ruairi Anderson, who is the Senior Policy Manager, and William Carlin, who's the Senior Policy Manager. And I welcome the Minister and his officials to the meeting and invite the Minister to make a short opening statement.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to yourself and to the committee. I'd like to thank the committee for the opportunity to briefly outline the aim and purpose of the new planning provisions. The provisions are contained across four Scottish statutory instruments and are technical procedural regulations which deliver principles that are already established in the Planning Scotland Act 2019. Scotland's plan-led system of development is widely supported, and these regulations are an integral part of the Scottish Government's wider planning reform programme, of which this committee will be familiar. The regulations provide further procedural information regarding amending the development plan and developing master plan consent areas. The powers for making amendments to the development plan are set out in primary legislation by changes made to the Town and Country Planning Act Scotland 1997 by the Planning Scotland Act 2019. The regulations being laid regarding amendments of the National Planning Framework and Local Development Plans provide the details of how the Act's requirements should be fulfilled. We have sought proportionality across both sets of amendment regulations while incorporating appropriate checks and balances to ensure transparency and fairness. With regards to master plan consent areas, the 2019 Planning Act introduced powers to establish these, and further regulations are required to set out the detailed procedures for their preparation and adoption. Master plan consent areas are an upfront planning consent, providing certainty and making places more attractive to investors. We envisage that MCAs could enable development on a range of scales and in different parts of Scotland. For example, it could be used to help deliver national developments on green ports and on new homes in urban and rural areas. Our 2024-25 programme for government commits that we will support early adopters through the rollout of MCAs, and officials are already engaging with several planning authorities to help them move forward. Each of the regulations being discussed today was informed by engagement with key stakeholders and a public consultation. Overall, respondents were generally supportive of a proposed approach to the regulations, and I want to assure the committee that the regulations being considered today have taken account of the comments raised through the public consultations. We have published a summary of responses, both report for both consultations. For the amendment regulations, there was strong agreement with the proportionate approach and the flexibility given to planning authorities within this. Similarly, for the MCA regulations, there was broad agreement that regulations should be kept to the minimum necessary in order to provide for maximum flexibility. Much of the detail of our expectations for MCAs will be set out in guidance, which we will publish when the regulations come into force. The Master Plan Consent Area Scheme Environmental Impact Assessment Scotland regulations mirrors the provisions within the Town and Country Planning Environmental Impact Assessment Scotland regulations 2017 and ensure MCA schemes are compatible with wider EIA requirements. This approach was welcomed by respondents to the consultation. I welcome the opportunity to answer any questions the committee may have regarding the details contained within these regulations. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much, Minister. And yes, we do have a number of questions. We're going to go through it. We'll look at the SSI's relation to the LDPs, then we'll go to the MCAs, and then finally MPF4 and the EIA MCA. So starting off with the LDPs, I'd be interested to hear from you when you expect a planning authority to make amendments to an adopted local development plan, and how often you'd expect this to happen during the lifetime of a local development plan.
Well, clearly that'll be up to local authorities, planning authorities, to bring those forward. And as you're aware, each of the planning authorities is currently going through the process of putting in place their initial local development plans under NPF4. To make the point that we wouldn't expect alterations to local developments, for example, for individual units or to take account of individual smaller applications, it's where there's a change they want to make in terms of what they've identified as areas for types of development within the plan, and that could be triggered by a range of requirements. So I wouldn't say that we have an expectation as to how often we would see that happening, but as I say, I wouldn't expect it to be a very irregular occurrence. As I say, it's up to the planning authorities to bring those forward as they see fit.
Okay, continuing with that, what impact might an LDP amendment process have on the planning authority's resources and already busy planning stakeholders? And who would be required to respond, who might be required to respond to multiple LDP amendments at one time?
Well, as I say, I wouldn't expect those to be happening very often, so I don't think they would bring forward officials and correct me, but if they want to amend the LDP, I would assume bring forward all the various changes they wanted to make at the one go, rather than have several changes to the LDP all running concurrently, if you like. The process, in terms of the substance of your question, we're very conscious of the challenges on resourcing that planning authorities, indeed the whole planning ecosystem, is suffering from, and we are taking separate steps, which I'll be outlining to Parliament in the near future, about how we can help to support and address those resourcing challenges. But as I say, it'll be up to planning authorities to decide when they think they need to make amendments to their LDPs, and to they will, I'm sure, factor in the resourcing requirements accordingly.
Okay, I just want to come back on the my first question, and just kind of dig in there a little bit more of, like, so why do we need to bring in this flexibility? What kind of situation are you imagining LDP would need to be amended?
Well, obviously they're in for a period of time, and planning authorities will go through the process with the evidence that they need to provide as part of that, and the gate checks. And as you know, we're already starting off on that process with a number of planning authorities, and they would do that on the basis of the information that they had available at that time. But of course, circumstances can change. It may be that the planning authority itself has got a change of direction, or other events may happen that require them to review, or evidence may come to light they weren't aware of previously that would require them to review the LDP. So we wouldn't want to be in a position where they were locked into something that couldn't be amended. So it's to allow that provision if it's required.
Have any local authorities come and ask specifically around, you know, I'm just wondering if anyone's come with kind of specific concerns around, oh, we might want housing, or we might want something that we're already aware of? And then I think the other piece that I'm interested in is, there's always been a question, I think, floating around a committee around local place plans, and how do we honour them? And so do you imagine that this flexibility would allow local place plans to be accepted into an LDP? If a community is slower off the mark, I know many of them are working on it right now, but if a community is slower off the mark to do that, do you imagine that that's also a possibility here with this amendment?
Yeah, it's exactly one of the situations where that may happen in the light of the new evidence coming forward and by way of a local development plan that a community brings forward that has, as you say, missed the initial deadline. That may be something the planning authority wants to take on board, and this gives them the scope and the provision to do that. In terms of indications from planning authorities, clearly they've been involved in the consultation for bringing this scope for amendments forward on, in this SSI, but as I said, they're all at various stages of pulling together their initial LDPs, so we're not yet at the stage where we'll be looking
okay,
to thinking about amendments to something. Yeah,
thanks very much. I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, convener. Good morning, Minister. It's just to ask you a little bit of, to say a little bit about the opportunities for the public to examine any proposed amendments to the local development plans. What are the kind of circumstances that would bring that about? And how long would you expect that kind of examination, public examination, to last?
Yeah, and I'll defer to officials in a minute to give more details on the consultation process that would be part of that. But yeah, there would be an opportunity through a consultation process to for members of the public to have sight of and indeed comment on those amendments. Rory, do you want to comment further?
Yes, thanks, Minister. Yes, just as Minister has said, we've set out in the regulations to be a little bit more proportionate, a little bit more streamlined in terms of the full review process, bearing in mind the burden that has on authorities. The regulations, these specific, bring forward a minimum 6-week public consultation, and there was wide-ranging support for that in our consultation. 84% of respondents agreed with that approach, and that's just to give local authorities the flexibility. As we say, it's going to be amended for local matters. There's no way for us to foresee what that might be across a 10-year cycle. So whether it's a minor amendment or a larger one, it's up for the planning authority themselves to decide how long a consultation is appropriate.
Okay, thanks very much for that. And in terms of our role, or the Scottish Minister's role in the process, Ivan, is your proposals today changing that in any way? I mean, what is exactly the role for Scottish ministers in that amendment process that may be happening locally? Do you have a role in that?
Yeah, I'll let officials comment on this as well, but it would be the same as it is for the creation of an LDP. So it would come to ministers, and we would we would look at that in most cases, or in all cases indeed. Rory, can you just clarify?
Yep, absolutely, Minister. The Minister's role in amendment of an LDP is very light touch. They would be notified of the proposed amendment via the public consultation, and we've stipulated that Scottish Ministers must be informed at that stage, so have a chance to represent. And then on top of that, if there is any unresolved representations as part of that public consultation, Scottish Ministers will be notified, and as per the process for a full local development plan, they would look to appoint an independent reporter, and the same process would then apply.
Okay, that sounds to me that there's no real change in respect to those matters being proposed or tabled this morning, Ivan. Thanks very much for that. Back to you, convener. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Willie. And I'm now going to turn to Alexander Stewart, who has some questions on master consent areas.
Thank you very much indeed, convener. Minister, the requirements to hold the public consultation events for master consent area schemes limited to the would be authorising major or national developments. Now, that would exclude consultation for an MCA that authorises up to 49 new homes in a single development. Can I ask why that is the case and what repercussions there could be from that?
So again, I'll ask officials to clarify the specifics on that, but the MCA process would broadly follow the existing process for planning applications, and that there would be the opportunity for members of the public to comment, and there would be consultation depending on the scope and scale of the proposal. But Rudy, again, just want to clarify on that, the specific details.
Minister, I'll hand over to Kristen for that.
As the Minister said, we're looking to kind of align with existing procedures for planning applications. So under the Development Management Regulations, the requirement for the equivalent pre-application consultation events is also for national and major developments. So what we've sought to do is just to align with existing processes in terms of our consenting.
Okay. And can I also ask where the requirement for an MCA document to be made available at public libraries and council offices. Now, that has been the sort of standard for the local development plans in the past. So why would there be a potential change in the master consent areas?
I think that we are comfortable that that's available online and sufficient, but again, and this would have been a part of the consultation process on that, as I understand it. But Kristen, again, do you want to comment on the specifics on that?
So an MCA is more akin to a planning consent rather than a local development plan. So again, we sought to mirror more of the provisions under development management regulations. And what we're trying to do is to balance the requirements between making hard copies available, the cost to authorities, but making sure that there is transparency in terms of access for people to get involved. We have got, though, got a requirement in the regulations, Regulation 7, that the authority must make a copy of the adopted master plan consent area scheme, so the document that gives that consent available for inspection in an office of the planning authority.
Okay. Thank you, convener.
Thanks very much, Alexander. And I'm now going to bring in Fulton McGregor.
Good morning. Thanks, convener. Good morning to the Minister and to officials. Continuing on for the last line of questioning there, I was wanting to ask about why 30 days has been chosen as a consultation period for the MCA. Do you feel that this is long enough to allow communities to respond, given some of the criticisms that we all hear as MSPs and our local communities about times to respond and feeling that, you know, and often they don't get the time. Where did the 30 days come from, Minister, and do you feel that this is enough time?
No, that's a good question. Well, first of all, to note it's longer than planning applications, which are typically a 21-day minimum period. The 30 days is the longest period from the various existing regimes that are in place, in this case, the environmental impact assessment process that we had to consider in this process. So we asked the consultation whether they thought that 30 days was sufficient, and we had overwhelming support. 73% of those that took part in the consultation indicated that they felt that was sufficient time. So we think it's long enough. I think it strikes that balance between the opportunity for engagement and the ability to put give scope for interested parties to comment, but also keeps the process moving along.
Thanks for that, Minister. And in terms of a hearing being held regarding a proposed MCA, do you expect that to happen? What circumstances do you expect that to happen under? And will planning authorities be required to revise MCA proposals, in the light of any hearings?
Well, there's also a process to be going through to get the MCA approved, and the local authority absolutely got the scope to alter the MCA as they take it through based on the any input that they take, and the MCA is designed to be a proactive process where the planning authority identifies a need, works with partners collaboratively to take forward something that they think makes those needs. But in terms of hearing specifically, that would be required where the scheme covers a national development, as has been identified in NPF4.
Okay, thanks, Vanessa. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Fulton. I just wanted to pick up a little bit there on these MCAs. So my understanding is that we'll bring these regulations in, and then kind of more of the detail will be left, will kind of come through in guidance. And I'm just a bit concerned. So I hear what you say, that 30 days is longer than 21 days, but we could be looking at quite big areas that could include a number of different pieces of work. It might be that it's not just housing, but it's housing, roads, and another infrastructural pieces. If you think about also, you mentioned at the beginning in your opening statement, Green Freeport as a potential place that MCAs might be used. So I'm just a bit concerned about the fact that we've got the regulations, but then details going to come through in guidance. And we've already seen the challenges of NPF4 coming in and kind of bedding in, with planners having a kind of sense of challenge, specifically actually around how do we kind of really make sure that the biodiversity aspect, which is right up there in the National Planning Framework as a key element of what we need to be considering. I just want to understand more, because the problem for me, I think, is that if we put things in guidance, that can be changed, that's more flexible than if we've got stuff in regulation. So just if you could speak to that.
Again, I'll let Kristen come in on the details on this, but the 30 days is in the SSI, so that's in the legislation. The guidance is really just to, as it says, to assist those that are going through the process on how they go about the process and how they take that forward. But I'll let Kristen talk through the specifics of what that engagement process would look like for larger MCA applications.
Thank you. Again, for larger MCA schemes, which cover bigger developments, there is the requirement for that equivalent to pre-application consultations, the two public events, and that's that opportunity for early meaningful engagement before it gets to that formal opportunity for representations. So there's further opportunities for people to get involved.
Can I just clarify, Kirsten, there, that's within the 30-day window?
No, that's ahead of that.
Okay, so there's even more time, there's more kind of more preamble in a way for people to
equivalent to a kind of pre-application consultation. There'll be the first public event which the authority will hold, an opportunity to tell people about their proposals for their MCA scheme, an opportunity to take feedback, and then there's a second event in which the authority can provide feedback, how they may have adjusted their proposals, and then they finalise the scheme, and then it's that document that they would write formal representations on.
Okay, thanks very much. We're now going to move on to National Planning Framework questions. I'm going to bring in Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. I wondered, under what circumstances would you expect to use the power to amend an adopted National Planning Framework?
So the National Planning Framework can be amended in a number of ways. Can be reviewed in a number of ways, but in terms of specific amendments, that would be at the discretion of ministers, where we see that there is some significant change to one of the policies that's come to light, and we feel that there needs to be an amendment taken forward. So we don't expect that to happen very often, but again, it's to give us that provision if it's required, if there's something significant where we see that there is a need to do that. Obviously, we're going through the process of NPF4 still bedding in, and with it being a new approach to planning, there are we're working through and issuing guidance and letters and so on as that happens. But if it came to the situation where we felt there was a need to amend one or more of the policies, then it would give us the scope to do that. But at the moment, we've got no expectation or plans to do anything specifically that's come to light on those amendments.
Okay, thanks. And why have you chosen the issues of combating rural depopulation, protecting disused rail infrastructure, and preserving peatland as worthy of that special consideration in the drafting of amendments?
I'm going to ask officials to come in and comment on the specifics on why they were included. I don't know who wants to pick that up.
Thanks, Minister. Yeah, I'll come in. It's just quite simply to mimic what's already in the Overline Act and what needs to be considered for consistency of the full MPF creation. We are mimicking that process and those considerations to make sure that when MPF is being amended, those full considerations are still given.
Okay, thank you. Just finally then, I think it's important to highlight that decisions around frameworks, development plans and similar, these can be a great way for local people to actively input into what their area needs or doesn't need without it being about a specific application. Yet folk do often wait to object to individual applications rather than feeding in at these stages. So what can councils, national government, other individuals, people on this committee do to encourage participation in local development plan consultations and including these amendments between each full review?
Yeah, well, in terms of the local development plans, I mean, the amendments to NPF 4 would obviously be a policy level, Scotland-wide, obviously. But in terms of local specifics, it's important that local groups and interested parties, individuals, take the opportunity at this stage to input to local development plans as councils, planning authorities are bringing those forward, and we've already talked on the committee here and in earlier sessions about the importance to encourage local communities to bring forward their local development plans to feed into that process. So as I say, it's important that we highlight that where we can to local interested parties so they've got that opportunity to feed into those LDPs.
Okay, thank you. That's me, Convener.
Thanks very much, Emma. I've got a couple of questions around the environmental impact aspect of the master consent areas. And I just kind of like in a bit of a way of clarifying of that process. So I think what I understand is that if a local authority brings forward a designated MCA, they have to do a kind of overall environmental impact assessment on that whole MCA, is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct, yeah. Unless officials are going to tell me there's any more nuance to that, but yeah, that's correct. Yeah.
Okay, I don't think anyone's moving. No. So okay. So I think one of the concerns I have is if a local authority designated an area as an MCA and they do this overarching environmental impact assessment, we could lose out on nuance when we get to more specific. Once the whatever's being decided, housing or roads or something like that, we could miss out on something that is overseen in that overarching area, and I've just got some concerns about that.
Yeah, no, it's a legitimate point to raise. So understanding, and again, I think William's going to come in a minute on this, is that the economic impact assessment will be done on the basis of what the proposal was for the MCA, what was going to be allowed to happen in the MCA. So it would be designed to cover that provision. And then clearly what you're allowed to do in the MCA has to be aligned with what has been approved in the MCA, which would have the EIA associated with it. But William, do you want to make any further comments on that?
We're waiting for your microphone to come on unmute.
Thank you. I just want to add clarification. Thank you, Minister. In terms of EIA, EIA is very specific to certain types of developments. It's not every master consent area will require an EIA. It's where the projects within them trigger the actual EIA requirements around what the activity is. So, and then there's a screening process as well to ensure that effectively that the projects that are in consideration are considered for their likely significant environmental effects. Now, in the situation where they trigger an EIA, then that EIA is going to be very much like what we have on the Town and Country Planning EIA regulations already, in that the project has to be subject to an environmental report that actually identifies the environmental effects for that project and give people an opportunity to feed into that process and ensure that there's no surprises that and the means to avoid or to mitigate or to reduce effects or to offset them are identified and given in a public context to that to the public that will be affected or likely to have an interest, and therefore have that communication being at the heart of EIA is delivered through the EIA process. Does that clarify?
Okay, I mean, yeah, I think that's helpful. I mean, I think one of the things I'm trying to get at here, maybe overall with, is that we've got we brought in the National Planning Framework and it's putting biodiversity right up there. And I know it's early days still, it's still bedding in, but I do see that we have problems at a local level of actually attending properly to biodiversity. I'm just hearing situations where councils are still kind of continuing with old practices around biodiversity that need to disappear in a way. And I think one of the concerns I have with create a master consent area and we have a kind of overarching EIA, and I hear your point that it gets triggered only if there's certain things that are going to be designated within that master consent area. But my concern is that we're not seeing best practice come through around biodiversity. We could create a situation where we do this blanket EIA and then actually down the line realize, oh, actually there's something within that context that we've missed. Do you see what I mean? I'm talking very abstractly here because I don't have a specific example, because obviously we're in a bit of an abstract situation as we start to understand our impacts on biodiversity more and so on and so forth.
Yeah. Is Minister okay for me to chat on that?
Absolutely, please, yeah.
Okay. Yes, I mean, environment is a very complicated and very, our own ecosystem is very complex. So therefore, planning authorities go to a lot of effort to actually understand their environment and the impacts of the development on that. It's not impossible that things will be missed, but what they have done is open it up for public consultation as part of the MCA development. So it's not just a single body bringing this together, but there's an opportunity to draw people and communities together and environmental NGOs to feed into that. So I can't say in every case an environmental implication isn't identified, but what we do is a very comprehensive and very sort of sophisticated environmental assessment that then at the end of the day, the decisions have to be taken based on the development as well as their likely environmental effects. And that's a very sophisticated and complicated thing that planning authorities do on a very regular basis.
Okay, thanks, William. I see Rory, you want to come in as well.
It was just to add to that, convener, in light of your question around the MPF4, I've drawn attention to the MPF4 delivery programme, which was published yesterday. We've set out a priority for guidance, and particularly your question was around biodiversity. So version 2 of that and incorporating that into the a metric. So just to clarify.
Great. Thanks so much for letting me know about that. That's really great. I've got, Minister, I've got one more question around the EIAs, and that's basically kind of an interest in who will pay for the environmental impact assessments associated with the MCAs. Would it be a planning authority that's required to do so while they're developing the MCA scheme, or would the costs fall to the eventual developer?
I need to be unmuted. Oh, there we go. There is scope within the regulations for planning authorities to pass that cost on to the developer. So that's been built in specifically for that situation in mind.
Okay, great. I'm sure that's very welcome to our struggling planning authorities and the need for us to move to full cost recovery and all of that kind of thing. So that's great. Okay, many thanks. That's I think we've come to the end of our questions. So many thanks for giving your evidence this morning. We're now going to turn to agenda item three, which is consideration of the motion on the Town and Country Planning Amendment of National Planning Framework Scotland Regulations 2024. And I invite the Minister to move motion S6M14644 that the local
government...
Okay, thank you. That the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee recommends that the Town and Country Planning Amendment of the National Planning Framework Scotland Regulations 2024 be approved.
I moved, Camino.
Thank you. Thank you. Do any members have any further questions for the Minister? The question is that motion S6M14644 in the name of Ivan McKee be approved. Are we all agreed? Lots of nodding of heads. Okay, great. I think we're all agreed on that one. Thank you very much. The committee will publish a report setting out its recommendations on the instrument in the coming days. And we now turn to agenda item five, which is the consideration of the motion on the second instrument, the Master Plan Consent Area Scheme, Environmental Impact Assessment Scotland Regulations 2024. And I invite the Minister to move the motion S6M14815 that the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee recommends that the Master Plan Consent Area Scheme Environmental Impact Assessment Scotland Regulations 2024 be approved.
It moved.
Thank you. Do members have any further questions for the ministers? Okay, I think I just have a comment which has kind of come out. I've already kind of brought it up in the evidence session, but it is this concern that I have. I mean, I obviously absolutely want to see environmental impact assessments and the importance of that connected to a master consent area scheme. The comment is that I want us to be really aware and vigilant as things evolve that we may need to readdress this if we start to understand that complexity that we were discussing earlier in terms of biodiversity, and that we revisit that if we're seeing that master consent areas, the schemes are allowing us to run away and kind of not actually give good enough consideration to what is actually so critical for life in Scotland, life on Earth. So I just want to make that comment. The question is that motion S6M14815 in the name of Ivan McKee be approved. Are we all agreed? Great, we're all agreed. Thank you. And the committee will publish a report setting out its recommendations on the instrument in the coming days. The next item on our agenda for today is consideration of the following negative instruments: Town and Country Planning Master Consent Areas Scotland Regulations 2024, the Town and Country Planning Amendment of Local Development Plan Scotland Regulations 2024, and the Building Scotland Amendment Regulations 2024. In terms of the two town and country planning instruments, I would be minded to reflect on the evidence we've heard today and bring them back to committee next week. Are members content with that? Yep, just nodding heads would be fine. Great, thank you. And insofar as the building regulations are concerned, do any members have any comments? No comments. Is the committee agree that we do not wish to make any recommendations in relation to this instrument? We're agreed. Okay, so thank you very much for that. We previously agreed to take the next items in private. So as that was the last public item on our agenda for today, I now close the public part of the meeting. Thank you very much.